One of the components of BatchView is the PI ProcessBook add-in. You will know if you have the PI ProcessBook add-in loaded if you have this symbol. It looks like a tank with a black arrow moving through it. That's called the batch group symbol. You'll also see that in your displays in the draw menu. If you see batch group, you will know you have the BatchView add-in installed on your machine. Now, the BatchView add-in contains four components. It's got a batch search component, a results table, a Gantt chart, and batch trends. And you can have one or more trends in your group. And the way the batch group works is that you're presented with a search component in ProcessBook. You display that information in ProcessBook. You get a results table. And the results table can feed both the batch Gantt charts, which also can feed the batch trends. So there's a lot of different ways that this becomes interactive once you place it into ProcessBook, and we'll show you how to do that. Some of the common things people use BatchView for is to do batch type comparisons. This is mostly using the Gantt chart functionality. People will do process value comparisons. This is primarily accomplished using the trending tools. And cycle time analysis. People want to see and analyze what their downtimes are for particular pieces of equipment. The plot time settings deserve some attention because they can be a little confusing. They're found on the settings panel. If you go into build mode and double click your batch group, you will get the batch definition dialog box and click settings. And you have three options in setting your plot time, and this is essentially your x-axis for the batch group. Relative start and end time, that's the default methodology. The start is your batch time start, and the end is your batch end. And if you wanted to change that at all by using setting it differently, like you wanted to start 10 minutes into the batch, you would simply put a plus 10M there, and that would start the batch 10 minutes into the batch. And that's actually shown on this slide where we have a 10-minute offset time into batch. You can see that the times along the bottom of my trend here start essentially at 10 minutes. We don't see the beginning of the batch, whereas in the top trend we have the entire trend shown. We start at the zero point of the batch. The last one, the ending one, is sort of a combination of the two, where it's a 10-minute offset, but it's time into plot. That means we actually start the plot time at 10 minutes, and that's the zero point. So the difference between time into batch and time into plot is essentially where it's showing you the zero point. If you use time into batch, it maintains the timing along the bottom of the batches and starts 10 minutes in, but if you use 10-minute offset time into plot, it actually sets that 10 minutes into the batch as the zero time of the plot and uses that as the axis. There's a couple other attributes here. You can use a relative time if you want to always have your times aligned to a certain component of your trend. Let's say, for example, I wanted all of my elements, my Gantt and my trends, to start with this pre-hydrolysis phase. I can align all of the things to the pre-hydrolysis phase, and that way all of my Gantts and trends will automatically align to that particular phase. So you can set that if you'd like. Or you can just say absolute. And absolute is simply going to give you a trend that's going to look like a ProcessBook trend where things aren't overlaid, but it's actually shown as actual time. And we'll see an example of where this is used a bit later. The batch trend configuration is performed much like the trend is in ProcessBook. If we go into ProcessBook and we look in our batch definition window and we select layout, for each of our trends we have a configure button. And I have one trend here, and I'll bring up the configuration. And you'll see the available aliases and tags aliases in the trend are displayed. This is the same as the initial configuration. But toward the bottom, we have a scaling setting. And the scaling setting is almost identical to the ProcessBook setting with one small distinction. We have this by tag slash alias. And so if we select single scale, we get one trace, one scale for all of our traces. This is identical to the way ProcessBook works. There's also a multiple scale option, and this again is identical to the way ProcessBook works, where if you have multiple scales with your plus tag aliases checked, you get one scale for each alias and one scale for each tag. So for each item that you're showing on the right, you get one scale, and that's pretty much the same as ProcessBook does. However, if you do not check plus tag alias in the configuration, what you'll get is you'll get a trace for every single, you get a scale for every single trace on the screen. And that is very different than ProcessBook. And ProcessBook's not showing you the same trace for multiple tags. There's also the trend format configuration where you can control pretty much everything you control in the ProcessBook standard trend object. You have line weights and styles for each pen. You have all the elements here, the text, the axes, the grids. You can control the line weight and color for that. You can display whether choose to display to show the title, the grids, the vertical scales, inside or outside access. And you can show a legend if you want by showing different items at the bottom of your batch trend element. So you have most of the same options that you have under format that you have in ProcessBook. They're just laid out slightly differently.